مولانا العظيم ان الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا ايها الذين امنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما والصلاه والسلام عليك يا رسول الله وعلى اليك واصحابك يا حبيب الله all praise honor glory belongs to Allah عز وجل endless peace blessings upon our master سيدنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه واله وصحبه وبارك وسلم After praising Allah, after sending durood upon our beloved, may Allah Azza wa Jalla shower blessings upon his companions, his wives, his noble household. Allah Ta'ala raise ranks of all awliya, shuhada, righteous ulama of Ahlul Sunnah.
Ameen.
Allah Azza wa Jalla give us steadfastness upon the right way.
Ameen.
Previous weeks we've been speaking on the arkan of Hajj. These being the days of Hajj, we've been speaking about the integrals of Hajj and Umrah. He mentioned about there being three types of Hajj. One is a Qiran, one is Tamattu, and one is Ifrat. The Qiran, when a person puts on Ihram and intends to perform Umrah and Hajj. And then there is the Tamattu, when he puts on Ihram, he performs Umrah, then he goes out of Miqat, takes his Ihram off, after performing Umrah, and then he goes out of Miqat again, puts Ihram on again, and comes back in to perform Hajj. This is Tamattu. Then the third type was Ifrad, which is Hajj only. And how is Hajj only done? Without any Umrah. Any of these three were valid. On the 7th of Dhul-Hijjah, it is the best time to put the Ihram on and prepare for Hajj, for the Hajji. And on the 8th of Dhul-Hijjah, the following day, is when the pilgrims go to a place called Mina, which is in Makkah al-Mukarramah, nearby. When pilgrims go to Mina on the 8th of Dhul-Hijjah, and which namaz do they pray there? It is sunnah to pray 5 namazes there. Zuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, and then Fajr in the following morning. The person stays the whole night in Mina, in the worship of Allah Azza wa Jal. And in Mina, there are special blessings of Allah Azza wa Jal as there are in every maqam during the Hajj. After Mina on the 8th, then the following day is the 9th of Dhul-Hijjah, the day of Hajj.
Subhanallah.
On the day of Hajj, on the 9th of Dhul-Hijjah at Fajr time, you pray Fajr in Mina. After you pray Fajr in Mina, then when the sun rises so much after Fajr, that the mountain of Sabir, which is opposite Masjid Khayf, when that is bright, then this is when the pilgrims start to make their way towards Arafat. The plains of Arafat, which historically is the place where Nabi Adam alayhi salam met Hazrat Hawa alayhi salam.
Subhanallah.
That is where all mankind began, particularly in the place known as Jabal-e-Rahmat, the mountain of mercy. So the pilgrims make their way towards Arafat. And before going to Arafat, it is sunnah, if a person can't, then to have ghusl, to have a bath. And when you reach Arafat, the pilgrims have to be in a state of fear, in a state of worry and anxiety, and also in a state of hope at the same time. That maybe Allah Azza wa Jal will punish me for my sins, for my wrongdoings, and maybe Allah Azza wa Jal will forgive me. The iman of the believer has to be in between the both. A person should try to stand near Jabal-e-Rahmat, but if not, there will be millions of people, then a person should at least find any space within the plains of Arafat. And it is false to stay for at least one moment, even walking through, even one moment to stay in the plains of Arafat is a farz. This is a major rukun of the Hajj. And this can be done from the time of Zuhr right through to Asr, even Maghrib and Isha, right down till Fajr of the 10th, which is Eid day. Any time between this, even one moment spent in Arafat, the farz will be done. But what is the sunnah? The sunnah is to stay there during Zuhr time and Asr time. And the prayers of Zuhr and Asr are combined in Arafat. This means The Zuhr is prayed right at the end time, and the Asr is prayed at its beginning time. So for example, if Asr starts at 3 o'clock, then Zuhr namaz would be prayed right at the end, like 10 to 3 or 5 to 3, like around that time at the end. And then Asr will be prayed at the very beginning time. During the stay at Arafat, there are many du'as. If a person buys a book such as Rafiqul Haramain, it's an excellent book. It's published by Dawood Islami.
Bishop.
I recommend this book for those who go for Hajj and Umrah. It has many du'as, and it tells you what to do, when and where in the places in Hajj. So this is a great day to seek the forgiveness of Allah Azza wa Jal. And it is a sunnah for the Haji not to keep a roza. The Haji does not keep a roza on the day of Hajj. But others who are outside, such as ourselves who are here, then it is a mustahab, it is good to fast on the 9th of Zulhijjah. So a person stays there until the morning on the 10th. And, Zuhr and Asr time. After Asr, when the sun sets at Maghrib time, then a person does not leave immediately. It's disliked to leave immediately. But when the sun sets and its darkness has spread, it has gone slightly darker, then the pilgrims make their way towards a place called Muzdalifah. After leaving Arafat, they go to the plains of Muzdalifah. And it is said that the rights of Allah Azza wa Jal, the guna against Allah, are forgiven in Arafat. And the guna which are done towards other people, they are compensated for in Muzdalifah. In other words, for example, a person has wronged other people. On the Day of Judgment, those other people are coming to you to seek their right. But when you will not be able to give, then Allah Azza wa Jal, due to your stay in Muzdalifah, inshallah, He will repay those people on your behalf.
Subhanallah.
So this is the blessing of Muzdalifah. Muzdalifah is to be stayed in. The wajib requirement is that in the time of Fajr, on the 10th of Zulhijjah, the following morning, to stay at least a moment in Muzdalifah is wajib at Fajr time. That you be in that place. If you be in that place, your wajib is fulfilled. If not, your wajib is not done. What is the sunnah though, is that you stay there after Maghrib and stay the whole night until Isha, after Isha until Fajr. So you are going to combine Maghrib and Isha in Muzdalifah. How do you combine Maghrib and Isha in Muzdalifah? First you will pray 3 farz of Maghrib. Then you will pray 4 farz of Isha. Then you will pray the 2 sunnat of Maghrib. Then the 2 sunnat of Isha, and then the 3 bitr of Isha. So that is how you will have combined them. There is one place in Muzdalifah known as Muhassir. Muhassir is the place where the Ashab al-Fil, the people of the elephant, were destroyed. Abraha and his army, they came to attack the Holy Kaaba. And Allah mentions, أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ فَعَلَ رَبُّكَ بِأَصْحَابِ الْفِيلِ.
No, not.
Have you not seen what your Lord did with the people of the elephant? What happened? Birds came. Allah sent a flock of birds which had pebbles, stones in their beaks, and they pelted them people and destroyed them in a place called Muhassir. No. But that's why it is marked, and it has barbed wire, and the police guard it, and pilgrims are advised not to go there. Because Allah, His azab descended at that place, we must not go there. So everything else, all the rest of Muzdalifah, we should. The best place to stay in Muzdalifah is Mash'arul Haram, the area known as Mash'arul Haram. But again, if it is extremely busy, then you can stay anywhere in Muzdalifah. Another point which I escaped my mind was that in Arafat, many awliya of Allah Azza wa Jal are present.
Subhanallah.
And many pious people, and even 2 prophets of Allah Azza wa Jal attend every year.
Subhanallah.
Sayyidina Ilyas alayhi salam and Sayyidina Khizr alayhi salam.
Subhanallah.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all tawfiq.
Ameen.
In Muzdalifah, the night is spent, Fajr is prayed. After Fajr is prayed, then when it is about to be sunrise on the 10th of Zulhijjah now, and this is the day of Eid, when it is about to rise, just before it rises, then you leave Muzdalifah and you return to Mina, the place where you were on the 8th. You return to Mina. What happens in Mina? On the 10th, The people have collected stones. In Muzdalifah, you will have collected pebbles. 49 pebbles at least. And these should be small pebbles. And not broken from larger stones, but ready ones. Small pebbles. 49 or even more. It is mustahab, good to wash these 3 times. Keep them on you. You can use stones from any part of the world, but it's better to take them from Muzdalifah. So now you are reaching Mina, and then you reach Jamratul Aqaba, the big shaitan. There are 3 pillars in Mina, which symbolize the shaitan. These were the 3 maqams when Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam pelted the shaitan. So this is where on the 10th, you will only throw stones, 7 stones, 7 pebbles, at the big Jamrah, the Jamratul Aqaba. And your left side is facing towards Qibla, like I am stood here. The left is towards the Qibla, and the right side towards Mina. So then, after pelting the Jamarat to the Aqaba 7 times, with 7 pebbles, you have to make sure that the stones are thrown by the person themselves. Another person cannot throw on behalf of someone else. Unless there is a valid reason, a person cannot even go there on a wheelchair. And the stones must reach within the Jamara within 1.5 yards. So this is a wajib requirement, the 7 stones are thrown on there. After this, the Qurbani is given, a sacrifice. And those Hajis who perform Umrah and Hajj, it is wajib upon them. It is wajib that they sacrifice an animal. The sacrifice of the animal is a wajib requirement, and it is done between the 10th and the 12th. The Ayyam al-Nahar are the 10th, 11th, and the 12th till Maghrib. So, animal is sacrificed. Which animal? This is even for Qurbani generally, which is wajib on all of us. One-seventh of a cow or camel. 7 people can contribute towards a cow or a camel. But if a goat is given or a sheep is given, a person must sacrifice a full goat or a full sheep. 1/7 of a cow or a camel. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sacrificed 63 camels in his farewell.
Subhanallah.
So this is Azim Qurbani, which is done in memory again of Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he was ready to sacrifice his most beloved Ismail alayhi salam for the love of Allah azza wa jal. So then after the Qurbani, then the halq is done. The head is shaved or it is cut. You are required to cut at least a finger digit of 1/4 of the hair of the head. This will fulfill the requirement. But best is to shave the entire head, and then a person is able to remove ihram. Now he is out of the restrictions of ihram. Then, during the day, in the 10th, 11th and 12th, during these days, you will perform tawaf-e-ziyara.
Subhanallah.
And tawaf-e-ziyara is the main element of the Hajj, the second main farz, which is to walk around the Kaaba 7 times with worship intention. This is the second major farz. So this is also done on the 10th of Zulhijjah, the second tawaf. The first tawaf when you went there, the 7 laps first which you did, was tawaf al-qudum, which was sunnat muwakkada. But this tawaf which you do now, it is a farz tawaf. And you'll be wearing normal sewn clothes for this. Because you've come out of ihram, then you can take a bath on the day of Eid, it is sunnah. And after that you wear normal clothes and then you go to perform tawaf ziyarat. These 7 laps, the first 4 of these laps are farz. The final 3 are wajib. So this is performed on the 10th of Zulhijjah. The following days then, the 11th and the 12th, you will go to Mina. And how many stones did we collect, pebbles? 49. 7 we already threw at the large Jamaratul Aqaba on the 10th. Yeah, we threw them in the morning hours on the 10th. The time when we pray Eid namaz. In the morning hours, we stoned the largest shaitan on the 10th. But on the 11th and the 12th, when you go to Mina, then beginning from the small shaitan, then the medium and then the large, in this order, 7 pebbles each will be thrown on each. So 21. On which day? On the 11th. And this must be done after Zuhr time. It cannot be done in the morning hours. If it's done in the morning hours, then you will incur a penalty. You will have to give a dam. You will have to sacrifice an animal for any wajibs missed. This is why it's so important to learn the arkan of Hajj. For any wajibs missed, you will have to give a dam, sacrifice an animal. On the 11th, after Zuhr, you will do this. On the 12th, you will do the same. You will throw 7 pebbles at the small, then at the medium, then at the large shaitan. So 21 and 21, 42 are finished. And then you had used 7 before. Spare pebbles are kept anyway, so that a person can fulfill this wajib in case they fall or anything of that sort. It is also important in Mina to be extremely careful. There is a huge rush in Mina and many people are killed, many people are shaheed. So in this place, if a person's shoes fall, a person's belongings, anything, you have to be extremely careful not to bend down and try to pick things up. A person can easily get crushed to death. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all tawfiq to attend these blessed places.
Ameen.
After the 12th, you've done the 11th and the 12th. If a person stays in Mina and it's Maghrib now, it's Maghrib after the 12th, then this person should stay the following day, the 13th as well. He should stay the 13th as well and do the same on the 13th. That is for the person who has stayed during the night. But if he leaves during the night, it is permissible. It is permissible for the person to leave during the night. If on the other hand, the person remained in Mina and it's now Fajr time, then it becomes wajib to do the stoning again on the 13th. If he left during the night, he doesn't have to give any dam. He doesn't have to give any sacrifice because he left early. But if he left on the 13th, on the morning at Fajr time, then he must give a dam, a sacrifice, an animal, because he missed something which became wajib upon him. After this, you do the stoning of the in Mina, then you go for a final tawaf, which is wajib. And this is known as tawaf-e-rukhsat. This is for the afaqi, the foreigners like us who do not live in Makkah al-Mukarramah. This is wajib upon us that we perform a final farewell tawaf. And this final farewell tawaf, 7 laps, and then go to the multazam on the cling to the wall of the Kaaba if you can find room, and kiss the black stone and cry and try to beg Allah Azza wa Jal to call us again and again, inshallah.
Inshallah.
And then to drink Zamzam as much as you can, and to walk away from the Kaaba to Allah with tears and with regret that maybe Allah Azza wa Jal has accepted this, but maybe due to my shortcomings He has not. Oh Allah Azza wa Jal, accept this out of your mercy. And then make dua for everyone, the Muslims, and then one leaves and then goes for ziyarah for Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam.
Subhanallah.
And the ziyarat in the barga of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is the sign of maqbooliyat.
Allah, bishak.
Allah tabarak wa ta'ala give us tawfiq to learn these arkan.
Ameen.
We have a gathering every Thursday and these arkan have been discussed in detail. The masail of zakat have been discussed in detail. This is farz ulum. Every Thursday at 6 o'clock in this masjid, we discuss these shari masail, which are obligations upon every Muslim. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala give especially the youngsters the ability to come to this gathering.
Ameen.
Every Thursday at 6 in this masjid, inshallah azwajal, make an intention to come.
Inshallah azwajal.
Just a few points to mention regarding the incident on the roads the other morning. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. 4 more young brothers, youngsters, have paid with their lives.
Allahu Akbar.
Once again, careless driving, dangerous driving. And I don't like to stand here and lecture people. This is not my job. But something which we have to take collective responsibility for is what happened on the roads yesterday.
Allah.
All of us as a community, we need to take a good hard look at ourselves. That what are our qirdar? What are our mannerisms? What are our ways? And where are we heading? As a society, we glorify wealth, we glorify dunya, we glorify fast cars, we glorify and respect and honor those who have the best car, who have the best money. And this culture has to be destroyed. This culture has to be broken. Muslims need to turn their attention towards the akhirah. We do not question our youth. Where are they getting their money from and where are they spending it on? My dear brothers and elders, I am not going to make a personal attack on the brothers who have passed away. Allah knows best where they were going and where they were coming from. And we must, as Muslims, have husn al-dhan. It's not a time to speak ill of the dead. But generally what we do know is that in our streets, the drugs are rife, right? Haram things are rife. Youngsters are drinking khamar. Youngsters are freely mixing and going clubbing and in pubs and away from the masjids. Our masjids are empty. Our masjids are empty. Okay? Why? Where are the youth? When the masjid, when the muazzin is calling towards Allah, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, where are the youth filling the rows? I mostly see elders in the masajid. Oh dear youngsters and parents, encourage your youngsters to come to masajid. Coming to a masjid is not the job of a Sufi sahab or a Maulvi sahab. Coming to the masjid is the work of a believer. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned that bear witness to the iman of the one who goes to the masjid. Youngsters must attach their hearts to the masjid and to the dhikr of Allah azza wa jal and the sunnah of his Habib sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. So this thing we need to focus on, getting our youngsters to come to the masjid and encouraging them to follow the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. This local masjid, our doors are open. And as I mentioned, every Thursday we have a youth gathering. We must fear for our lives, not just for our deaths. That every time an incident like this happens, then everyone says, oh, now you know Imam Sahib, speak about it, tell people this, that, the other. But what am I going to do? I am going to speak, lecture, shout, yell, and after a few days, everything goes back to normal. And brothers are on the roads speeding again. Brothers are on the roads driving crazy, overtaking on the other side, you know, doing all sorts, crazy maneuvers, getting chased by police. If the police stop you, if the police chase you, then stop. Just stop your car. Just stop your car and get out of the car, speak to them. Deal with it, with whatever matter is coming. Do not take a police chase. You're risking your own life. You're risking the lives of your passengers. You're risking the lives of people on the streets. You are risking the lives of others. And you will be responsible. Every time you get behind that wheel, you will be responsible. And if you've taken the life of someone, then you will have to know, you will have to live with that regret that someone's mother had to open the door and the police came knocking on her door and said, your son is no longer coming home.
Allahu Akbar.
Someone's father will have to wake up to this reality that his son, his putter, is no longer coming home.
Allahu Akbar.
And when that happens to your own family, when that happens to yourself, wallahi, you will feel it. It is a very, very sad, a waste of life and waste of youth that for a person to go in this way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our youth.
Ameen.
Give our youth hosh. And give our elders hosh as well. To guide your youngsters, give them tarbiyah. Do not wait for these tragedies to happen and then for everyone to start doing hoo-ha and crying about it. No. We need to plant the seeds now. And how do we plant the seeds now? We need to become people of namaz.
Subhanallah, bishop.
We need to become namazi. We need to start, you know, telling our children namaz paro. Right? Establish your salah. We need to send our children to masjid to pray there, to learn. We learn some farz ulum now. I did not give up. The arkan of hajj and umrah, I mentioned the arkan of hajj. This is an obligation. We need to act upon these obligations. And we need to have an attachment to true role models. Our role model is not the Joe Bloggs who drives the Mercedes or drives the, you know, fastest, you know, car. And our youngsters are so obsessed with these things. The young kids who come to the masjids, they're obsessed. Why? Why are they glamorizing this lifestyle? It's nothing. Muslims need to teach their children, dunya kuch bhi nahi. Jab koi dunya se chalta hai, to haath khali hote hain. Sikandar Rum ke bhi khali the, Nimrud ke, Firaun ke, sab ke. Kisi ne bhi apna maal saath leke dunya se koi bhi nahi gaya. To hame kya umeed hai? Lambi umeed rakhna ye kufar ka kaam hai. Ad-dunya sijnul mu'min wa jannatul kafir. The dunya is the paradise of the kafir and it is the prison for the believer. In prison you are going to struggle. So we have to struggle. Nothing comes easy. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala give us tawfiq to have sabr and to establish our namaz.
Ameen.
Aindah hum namaz ko qaim karenge.
Inshallah.
Allah tabarak wa ta'ala kisi qawm ki halat ko nahi tabdeel karta jab tak wo khud tabdeeli le aaye. To tabdeeli lene ka matlab ye hai ke sunnat pe qaim hona sakhti se.
Inshallah.
Sarkar e alam sallallahu alaihi wasallam ka bataya hua tareeqa usko mazbooti se pakad lo. Aur inshallah azza wa jal isse tum bhi bachoge aur tumhari aulaadein bhi bachengi.
Inshallah.
Allah tbarak taala ki bas tawfeeq. One last reminder, every Thursday 6 o'clock, please send your youngsters to the masjid. They will be safe. They will have farz knowledge. They will do zikr of Allah and his rasool sallallahu alaihi wa sallam, and come inshallah they will know how to honor their parents. and inshallah to how to honor the community as well and society at large. وما علينا إلا البلاغ المبين.